everyone. Again, my name is Madeline, and Mr. Super actually pronounced my last name right on the first try, which never happened. So, snaps to you. So, I'm a graduate student in the Biological and Environmental Sciences Department at Georgia College, and I work with Dr. Bruce Snyder. So, this is my part of my thesis project. We're looking at the soil macroinvertebrate responses to wildfires up here in Blue Ridge Mountain. So, a little background information. There have been very few studies on the effects of fire on soil fauna communities, and to our knowledge, there have been no studies done in the eastern deciduous biome. So this is relatively new information that we are looking at. And there is becoming an increasing concern for the impacts of fire, and that is partly due to more prevalent wildfires, and that can be attributed to fire suppression that has largely affected the United States, and fuel loading, which causes more severe wildfires, and also the implementation of prescribed fire as a management tool. So we're wondering, how do these affect these different fauna communities? So a little more background information. When we're talking about macroinvertebrates, it's essentially anything that you can see with the naked eye that does not have a backbone. And there are terrestrial and aquatic macroinvertebrates. So this study was focusing on the soil macroinvertebrates. And so those are any invertebrates that are larger than 2 millimeters in size, and that are typically considered ecosystem engineers. And so you can see some examples here. We have some gastropods, isopods, millipedes, as well as earthworms. So fire effects on soil, the great ecological response to a lot of questions, it depends. So the effects on the soil largely depend on fire severity, and fire severity can greatly vary and depend within a fire area. Soil is a really good insulator, and so a lot of times most of the effects of fire, and when we're talking about effects in this case, it's largely heat, does not penetrate more than 5 centimeters down into the soil. And most of the effects are limited to the leaf litter layer, which causes destruction of habitat and food resources, especially for leaf litter dwelling macroinvertebrates such as millipedes. And so as we can see here, there's a diagram of just a basic soil horizon profile. I've expanded the O horizon, where most of the fire effects will occur, into the OI, OE, and OA layers. And largely the OI layer is the one that is affected the most. And so for our hypothesis and kind of what we were looking at within this study is how our soil dwelling macroinvertebrate communities, are there structure changes within those, as well as changes within the leaf litter communities, and comparing those as well. And we suspect that potentially the leaf litter, there might be more changes within the leaf litter community, again, due to that habitat and food resource losses. So for our experimental design, we've been collecting seasonally from 2017 through 2020 and potentially into 2021. We have 3 field sites. 2 are located in Georgia, and 1 is located in Tennessee. So our first site is at the Rough Ridge Fire, which is in Crandall, Georgia. The second is the Rock Mountain Fire, which is in Dillard, Georgia. And the third fire, which you guys are all very familiar with, is the Chimney Top Fire that was here in Gatlinburg. At each of our 3 sites, we have 5 burn plots and 5 unburned plots, which are all about 30 meters apart, so they're in very close proximity to each other. And so 4 field collection methods. Within the study, we are looking holistically at all leaf litter dwelling macroinvertebrates and all soil dwelling macroinvertebrates, but we do have some focal taxa that we are studying. So one of the first focal taxa is millipedes, and for that collection method and other leaf litter dwelling macroinvertebrates, we are using timed hand collection. So at each of our plots, we either have a nail or a flag that pinpoints the center of the plot, and we measure out 2 meters and to designate our collection area. And we are collecting for 30 person minutes. So if it's 1 person collecting, they would collect for 30 minutes. If it's 2 people, we both collect for 15 minutes each. For the next 2 focal taxa, we have invasive earthworm species and native earthworm species, and the second collection method for earthworms as well as other soil-dwelling macroinvertebrates is digging soil monoliths, which are 30 by 30 by 30 centimeters, about a cubic foot, and then hand sorting those again for 30% minutes. For the in-lab procedure, once we have collected all of the invertebrate species, and again, I want to preface that while we do have focal taxa, we are looking for any macroinvertebrates that we find within our collection period. We have identified all soil species to, of course, taxonomic level. What I mean by that is the spider, beetle, very coarse. But for our focal taxa, those have currently been identified to the order level, and then we hope to identify them to a species level. Here is some really preliminary data that we have from this project. And for the next few slides, the graphs will follow the same kind of format. So if you look at the top with the black bars, that's to represent the burn plots. The green is representing the unburned plots. From the far left, we have our Great Smoky Mountain site. In the middle, we have our refuge site. And on the right, we have the Rock Mountain site. So this is going to follow kind of the same format for the next few slides. So this is looking at the average number of individuals for leaf litter dwelling organisms. The error bars do represent standard error. As you can see, they tend to follow relatively the same trend seasonally. There are a few slight differences. So if we look at the unburnt plot for summer of 2018 at the Rock Mountain fire, there is a significant increase between the burned plots, but relatively follows the same trends. Here is showing the average number of individuals for soil dwelling macroinvertebrates that we found, and again, follows relatively the same trend. We'd like to point out some significant differences between the burned plots versus unburned plots of the Smoky Mountain site. There is a significant increase a larger number at the burned site. Here we have the average number of taxa that were found across each site for leaf litter dwelling organisms. And again, kind of the whole theme of this follows the same trend. There are little differences. So for the burn plot of summer 2018 for Rock Mountain, there is a larger number, but again, following the same trends. And then lastly, we have the average number of taxa for the soil dwelling macroinvertebrates. And again, same trends, but I would like to point out that for the Great Smoky Mountain site, there does seem to be a larger number of taxa within the burn plots versus the unburned plots. So now that we have this preliminary data, kind of what are we looking at and what direction could this potentially take the research? So we definitely see some seasonal trends across the sites. And as we continue to add more data, we wonder, will those trends continue as well? There are certain site and season specific differences that I have pointed out on each slide. And so our next thinking about what is driving those differences. And again, how will this change as we do more collection and as we add more data to this? For continuing research, we are planning another collection date this semester, and as well as for the fall of 2018, and then hopefully through spring of 2021, continuing to sort through the collected data that we have, as well as refining species identification, so the focal taxa that we have are identified to order, and we hope to bring those to a species level. A tangential project that we are interested in doing is DNA barcoding for the focal taxa, and so planning to start DNA extraction so that in PCR amplification, so we can start that DNA barcoding database. And that is important because millipedes can only definitively be identified to a species level with the male reproductive organ, which is gonopods. So what does that mean about the females and juveniles? If we extract DNA from the males and get that barcoding system in place, then we are able to include the females and juveniles within our data sets as well. So it increases the data for our study. I have a few acknowledgments. So thank you so much to the Great Smoky Mountains National Park System for granting us research and collection permits. Thank you to the U.S. Forest Service for helping fund this project. This is a project in conjunction with them as well. Thank you to Georgia College and State University Biological and Environmental Sciences Department for helping support our research. Thank you to my lab mate, Garrett Harrison, for all the help with the preliminary data sorting. And then thank you to any different undergrad students for help with field selection. So. Okay. Any questions?
You said there were five burned and five unburned?
Yes, ma'am. So at each of our three sites, we have five burned plots and five unburned plots. And so we have two different collection methods that we incorporate at the burned as well as the unburned. So for leaf litter dwelling macroinvertebrates, we do the timed hand collections within the plot and the leaf litter. And then for the soil dwelling macroinvertebrates, we are digging the soil monolith and it's hand sorting through that soil monolith.
So it would be a third of 30 minutes total per plot?
Yes, ma'am.
I know you said that you collected, you know, all taxas, but for your focal taxa, were there any kind of criteria like why Milledgeville's or earthworms important?
So Milledgeville's and earthworms are largely what our research lab focuses on, and so that's part of why the focal taxa for us. And also millipedes play an important role within the ecosystem, being ecosystem engineers, and their habitat is in the leaf litter, and that is largely their resource as well. So we think that if a fire were to come through and burn the leaf litter layer, they would be the most affected taxa by that, or potentially be the most affected taxa by that.
Across sites, was like litter depth recorded or added into consideration?
Don't believe so, but there is thought that potentially why there is not as much of a difference between leaf litter and soil dwelling plots is there was a very severe drought before the wildfires, which could have driven typically leaf litter dwelling organisms into the soil, which we think that might be cause for the homogeneity across the sites.
Thank you very much.